set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. You sound good this morning. Keep it going. Come on. Who brings the chaos? Who brings the chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Yes, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All right, let's sing Worthy is the Lamb. Lift it up. Come on. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Let's hear the voices. Come on. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing it out. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. You are Lord. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy, sing it. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Lord, you laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Yes, all that you've done for me. Oh, yes, Lord, we sing for all that you've done for me. Come on, let's thank God for that. Woo.
Well, good morning. It is good to see you today, and we are excited to be back in person yet again, and I want to share with you just a couple prayer requests as we begin our service together, some things that you can be praying for. And let me mention to you that Jack Johnson heads to Ohio State this Tuesday to have further treatments or further, not treatments, but looking into further a plan of action for his cancer. And I'll be praying for Jack and Ruth. I know that they would greatly appreciate that. And then last evening, Phyllis Sapp went home to be with the Lord. And I want to continue to pray for the family. And I know many of you have been already, but wanted to update you, let you know how you can continue to pray for their family. And Alice, you know that we love you and that we've been praying for you as well. And so it's good to see you today also. So much going on, but it is good to see you. And if you're joining us by live stream this morning, we want to welcome you as well. And looking forward to what God has for us as we talk a little football today. And I want to share with you some thoughts from Exodus chapter 20, okay? So let's bow in a word of prayer and let's begin our service this way. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for how you can use it to transform our hearts and to transform our lives. God, we know what grace is about if we've been in church at any length. And so, Lord, we thank you for that grace. Lord, we don't deserve it. Lord, we certainly cannot earn it. But, Father, instead, you loved us enough to come and to die for us on the cross, to be buried and raised again, so that we can have eternity with you in your presence and perfection, so that we can enjoy forgiveness of sins. And so, God, we thank you for the gospel. And Lord, I pray this morning for Jack and for Ruth. Lord, I know that these are trying times for them, that they are immensely concerned about Jack's health. And so, God, I pray for wisdom and direction for the doctors at the James. Pray that you would comfort them and strengthen them, and we as a church would come alongside of them and be a support system for them to go through this time as he deals with his cancer. And Father, for the Saps, God, I pray that you would comfort them, that the Holy Spirit would have his ministry and his work accomplished in their lives. And God, I just pray that you would continue to minister to that family. And again, that we as a church would come alongside of Alice and the rest. And Lord, that we would encourage them. And God, we just thank you for Phyllis's life. And Father, now as we continue in worship, God, I pray that you would be pleased with what you hear. God, as we study your word, that you would use it in a great way. God, our heart would be that we would have a better understanding of your word and of who you are. Lord, that we would worship you in a better way, that we would be more like Christ as we leave here. And so, God, we are going to commit this time to you and ask that you would be honored through it. We pray all this in his name. Amen.
How much do you love Jesus this morning? How much do you love Jesus this morning? Say amen. I'm telling you, this moment is not about just corporate singing. And it can be made about that sometimes. We get into the habit of coming to church and doing five or six songs, and then James comes up, gives a message, or Jerry, if James isn't here, will preach, and you know, we have an altar call or a wrap-up, and then we go home. That's not what this moment is about. You know that, right? We come into this house to give back what God has given to us, to worship him with our voices, with our hands, and sometimes it doesn't feel like a lot. Sometimes it feels like, you know, like I wish sometimes I could thunder like the storm, you know, or just to express how I feel to God for all he's done for me. So as you sing these next songs, especially this one we're about to sing, sing it from your heart, sing it to him. If you got to look up at the words, look at them, but make it a prayer of worship and praise to him for all that he's done and for all that he's going to do in our lives this week and for the weeks to come. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Lord, you are worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, Jesus, the name. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Oh, yes, Lord. Worthy, sing it. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Isn't he worthy? Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name, everybody, sing it. Jesus, the name above every other name. Oh, yes, it is. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Sing worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy, come on. There is no one like. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Sing, show me. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and love me with your love. Those are. Sing, holy. Come on.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in one. Lord, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Oh, 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 you're worthy, Lord. Oh, yes, you are. I will build, sing it. And I will build my life upon your love. It is the firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not,
come on, sing it again. And I will build my life.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be
sing holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those.
Lift your voice and sing it.
Holy, there is no one.
Sing it to him.
There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and
tell him to show you. Come on.
Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
That's what we ask this morning, Lord. We need you to move. We need you to show us. We put our faith and we put our hope, our trust in you, because you are our firm foundation. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily.
I surrender all. Lift it up. Come on.
I surrender all. Oh, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all
to Jesus.
All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus.
Sing it like you mean it. I surrender all. Come on.
I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. to Jesus I surrender. Make me Savior, holy thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit. Truly know that thou art.
Come on, lift your voice and sing it. I surrender all. Take the instruments back. I want to hear them.
I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Sing it again. I want to hear your voices. Lift it up.
I surrender all. Oh, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender.
So this week, I try not to make these little intros for the sermon to be just about weird things that happen to me, but weird things keep happening to me. So I went to the eye doctor yesterday, and the eye doctor, I got new glasses, and I couldn't see out of the glasses. And I was trying to figure out, is it the prescription that's wrong or the glasses that are wrong? And so I'm sitting there, and she's taking me through, putting on the glasses, taking them off, you know, is one better, is two better? And I say, you know, when you ask that, when you say, is one better or two better? Well, two is better, but it's still blurry, and I guess I'm just getting old. I guess that's as good as it can be. And she said, yeah, you know, you are getting older and wiser. And I said, wider? Did you just say that? And we laughed for 5 minutes, and then I went to my car and I cried. So, but I got to thinking about that we expect our doctors, our professionals, to tell us the straight truth, to really tell us what is real. But it isn't always that way. Whether it's a mistake, I assume older but wider is a mistake, or whether it's on purpose, we sometimes just don't get the clear message. And God is not like that. And today we're going to be looking at Exodus 20, very well-known passage. It's really the Ten Commandments. But here's the most important thing. We skip over the first verse far too often. The first verse of Exodus 20 says, I am the Lord thy God, which hath brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Then he says, you shall have no other gods before me. We look at this list as a list of do's and don'ts, and maybe appropriately. But the truth is, God is saying, listen, I'm the one that released you from nearly 500 years of slavery. Now let me give you the straight truth about what will make you happy, what will give you a fulfilling life. In other words, he's like an ophthalmologist. He's saying, help you see the world crystal clear. And so as we go through this message today, and as we go through the worship, we should think about who God is. What would motivate the creator of the universe to give us a list of things that will make us more fulfilled and live a happier life? Let's continue worshiping together.
So, Jeff, what you're saying is, now that I'm older, these are not love handles, these are wisdom handles, right? Okay, I like that. My wife's not going to go for that, but I like that. I wanted to do this song this morning. It's one of those songs that just feels like it was written for me. And I guarantee you, as you hear the lyrics, you're going to think the same thing. But I want you to sing along on the chorus if you want to. It's just another, opportunity for us to worship. Oh Lord, you've searched me, and you know my ways. In every season, I know you love me. Your holy presence surrounding me. Sing it. At the cross I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. No, you have overcome the grave. Glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now? At the cross, lift it up. At the cross I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love. You have overcome. Glory fills the highest place. You tore the veil. You tore the veil. You made when you said that it was done. You tore the veil, you made a way. When you said that it was done. And when the earth falls from my eyes, and you stand before me, oh, I know you love me. Oh, I know you love me. Sing at the cross. Sing at the cross, lift it up. At the cross, I bow my knee, where your blood. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the blood, for the sacrifice you made for us. Thank you that you overcame the grave, that you didn't just stay dead, Lord, but 3 days later you rose again, and because of that, we have hope. We will triumph life over death, and we will spend eternity with you one day, and I'm so thankful. Bless James today as he brings the word, Lord. And may we all leave this place encouraged and changed, not because of anything that we've sung or said, but because your presence has been here. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can I ask you to go to Exodus chapter 20 with me? Now I want to do something a little bit different. I'm going to throw a curveball into our study this morning. Turn to Exodus chapter 20, and when you get there, look this way so I know you're tuned in with where we're at. But I want to do something real quick. How many of you, I'll tell you what, let's do this. Just for sake of confidentiality. How many of you, why don't you do this? Close your eyes and bow your heads just for a second. Don't fall asleep. Okay, this is not the invitation for a nap. But let me ask you this. How many of you came in this morning needing a reminder of the love and the power of the cross of Christ? How many of you that served as a good reminder for you? My hand is right here with you. I needed to know that. I needed to be, maybe not even know that, just to be reminded of that fact. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, because that's a good portion, and I think that's why Sunday services and worship is so vitally important. Not that we can't be reminded of that throughout the week, but when we come together corporately, we are reminded of the love of Christ and the power and the grace that is found in the cross. And so here's what I wanted to do, because I don't know about you. Maybe things moved a little bit smoother for you today than it did I. But I am in another one of those states right now where I feel a mess and not focused, not ready for what God has for us. That song was helpful to refocus. But I want to take just a minute and let's have a word of prayer. And I'm going to ask you right in your seat to join me in praying and asking God to help you focus. Because, and to be selfish and totally transparent, I need this for a minute, okay? To be able to be refocused on the morning. And so let's do this. Let's pray, and then we're going to hop right into Exodus 20. And I believe that what we're going to study this morning, for some, might be seriously the difference between life and death. And I want to be focused and do the best that I can through the help and the grace of God to be able to communicate His Word well. And so let's pray, and would you join me in praying? Father, we do ask now, and we do thank you for that grace and that love that was demonstrated on the cross. God, I needed that reminder today. I needed that last song to be able to refocus on you. Lord, there's a lot of moving parts right now. Some of them aren't moving as well as others. That could be a hang-up. That could be a distraction. But God, I thank you for the work that was put into the worship time this morning to lead us in song and to bring us back to the cross. And Lord, as we just sang about coming to the cross and kneeling, God, I know right now that there is nothing better than to kneel before the cross. Nothing else is even worthy of our kneeling. God, this morning I pray that you would refocus us on your word. God, I know that there's a lot of concerns. There are a lot of distractions right now in this room. So Lord, I ask that you would remove them. I know this is a little unorthodox. I get that. But God, I pray for our time around your word. I pray for clarity. I ask that the Holy Spirit would focus us. And again, please remove distractions. God, I pray that we would have an amazing time around Exodus chapter 20 as we jump into it this morning. Lord, we do love you. We do thank you for what you did on our behalf. God, our desire is to glorify you with our lives. And may that be done over the next few minutes as we study your word. We thank you, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you for that. I greatly appreciate it. On Blackwell's Island, there is a graveyard that exists for criminals. On one of those tombstones of a man by the name of John Smith, the inscription reads this: "Here lies the fragments of John Smith, who contradicted his maker, played football with the Ten Commandments, and departed this life at the age of 35. His mother and wife weep for him, and nobody else does. May he rest in peace." As we come to Exodus chapter 20, I'm sure that you're familiar of the contents of the text outlining for us the Ten Commandments. But I want you to think about that inscription across that tombstone as it compares our keeping of the commandments to a game, to simply a challenge between two teams. And I want to ask you this morning, is this our approach to the commandments of God? Do we look at the thou shalts and the thou shalt nots of Scripture and view them more or less simply as just a game to be played? And like as is true about football, we know that when teams, Lord willing, sometime down the line, get to take the field again, you'll have two opposing teams and they go at it for however many minutes are dedicated to that game. And similarly, our perspective on the law or on the commandments take two different teams. On one side of the ball, you might have this group called the legalists who believe that they are to live and to die by the commands of God. And for them, the submission to and the adherence to the law is the measure visibly of their spirituality. And so, if we are to play the game of keeping the law, if I think that I am doing things better than you, then guess what? I'm the spiritual one and you need to get right with God. And it's this massively comparative game where instead of ourselves coming before the cross, as we just sang, and comparing ourselves to the holiness of God, we play the comparison football game of to other people in the room. And you know what the beauty of this is? When we get distracted from comparing ourselves to the Lord and we start comparing ourselves to other people in the room, guess what? Inevitably, you will always find somebody that we think we're more spiritual than. And so is that a win? Did God give us the Ten Commandments so that we can literally base our spirituality or my level of spirituality on my ability to adhere to commands? You see, the longer then that I'm saved by grace through faith alone, I am no longer saved by grace through faith alone when I believe my spirituality is based on the commands. I have added to salvation my ability to obey commands. That's what we would call legalism. When we take faith and we add to it obedience to the law. Well, as I told you, there were two different teams. On this side, you have the legalists. On this side, let's call them the lawless, because I couldn't think of another word, but we had to go with L's. On this side, you have those that would say, well, I'm already saved by grace. I'm already forgiven of my sins. Therefore, I can go out through life and do exactly as I please because, one, I'm already forgiven. And if it's bad enough, I'll just ask for forgiveness again, and the grace of God will cover me. All things will be fine. I move on through life doing whatever I desire, totally ignoring the commands of God. Now, I know that these are kind of the two extremes to which the pendulum can swing. I get that. But I wonder this morning if either one of those are a biblical approach, or if they are, which one's right? And I would suggest to you this morning that the keeping of the Ten Commandments is not a football game. Nor is it our basis of our spirituality, nor is it our permissiveness to go out and do what we want and to sideline, literally, the commands of God because we're already saved by grace. Paul had tons to say about that in the book of Romans. God's relationship with Israel, as we have been studying in the book of Exodus, I want you to summarize it or remember in your mind, if there was to be kind of an overarching text of the book of Exodus, kind of a theme verse, if you will, Exodus chapter 6, verse 7 gives it to us. Here's what God tells Israel. You ready? And I will take you to me for a people, and I will be to you a God. And ye shall know that I am the Lord your God, which bringeth you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. Now watch this. Stay with me, okay? This is going to get kind of deep, but we're going to dig this morning. I want you to notice the progression of Israel beginning in bondage in Egypt. They found themselves, first of all, according to Exodus chapter 6, verse 7, they found themselves originally as slaves. They were under the burdens and the bondage of the Egyptians. Well, God intervenes, sees their need, and redeems them. And you see that in the text where God says, I am the Lord your God, which bringeth you out from under the burdens of Egypt. So he sees Israel where they are. He does not leave them in that condition. As a matter of fact, he comes alongside of them, and he provides for them redemption. He buys them back. He releases them and grants them freedom. But after that redemption, verse number 7 says, I will be to you a God, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God. What's he saying? Once I redeemed you, then this unique relationship with me continues. And we grow closer. Now think about this. The relationship between God and Israel for the first 19 chapters of the book of Exodus has only continually taught us how growth looks like. Sometimes there's struggles. Sometimes there's a stretch of faith. Sometimes there's the feeling like maybe God's turned his back on me. All of these things, even the plagues, if you remember, God interjected into the equation so that the bottom line would be that they would know that I am God. It wasn't to the glory of Moses. It even wasn't to the glory of Israel. God allowed all of the circumstances of the Egyptian captivity and the release of Israel and the plagues and the crossing of the Red Sea and the providing of water twice and the providing of manna and quail once so far. He allows all of that to take place. Sure, Israel is the recipient of those blessings, but the goal of that was not with Israel in mind. It was so that God would get the glory for what had taken place. They move from slaves to redeemed to free to begin a relationship with God. And so as God continues to develop that relationship with Israel by strengthening their faith, we enter chapter number 20, and the relationship is now going to go a little bit deeper between God and Israel. Because if you remember the beginning phrase of chapter 6, verse 7, he says, I will take you to me for a people. Can I remind you this morning, God has already given to Israel the right to go and to take the promised land. They hold in their hand, if one existed, the deed to the property of the promised land. Their goal was to move into freedom and to make it to the promised land. It was theirs for the taking. However, the goal of the freedom that they find in redemption was to be used for God's glory and not just for man's gain. And so Israel's possession and their enjoyment of the promised land directly correlated with their obedience to what we're going to study, to the law. And so as God now enters into this covenant relationship with Israel, he hands down what we refer to as the Ten Commandments. But I want you to know this. We need to remember really three numbers this morning, three statistics. 10 would be kind of the middle line. Okay, 10 is what we find in Exodus chapter 20. But I want you to remember also the number 613. Because what we understand is, as a matter of fact, ancient rabbis recorded 613 separate commandments in the entire law of Moses. But as they whittle it down and create a foundational list, they find Exodus chapter 20, the Ten Commandments. So now we have to ask ourselves this, right? Why? Why commandments? How many of us really enjoy living subservient to rules? So I'm the only one that doesn't like them. All right, fine. Thank you for putting me out on the island as if I didn't feel that far enough already. How many of us really enjoy living subservient to rules? We don't enjoy them. I mean, think about how many we break. Obviously, because of that factor, I mean, did you enjoy the speed limit on the way here? Did you follow it? Don't answer that. Do you enjoy the daily calorie intake that they suggest? Oh, let's not go there. How about we go away from that one? Do you enjoy the laws that are in place? Some of them, yes, because we enjoy the most the laws that we reap the most, what? Benefit from. And the ones that we don't really agree with or we don't like the benefits that are there, those are the ones that we say, well, that's not really for me, a.k.a. the speed limit, right? I got to make up time. I'm running late. I have an appointment. What is posted on that sign is irrelevant to me because why? Because I don't like it. So why does God feel the need to issue 613? As a matter of fact, we'll just break it down into 10. Do we really need rules, or why can't we just make them up as we go? That'd be nice. That'd be one way to handle it. What I want you to look into Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, and believe it or not, we're not even going to get to the Ten Commandments this morning in their entirety. I want to show you a little bit about the law this morning. I trust that it'll be an encouragement to you. I really believe this is the perspective on the law that we need to gain. Every commandment that we read about in Exodus chapter 20 reveals to us an inside peek of what God's character is all about. It reveals to us God's perfection. The Jews referred to the Ten Commandments as the Ten Statements or the Ten Words. Where did they get that from? Verse number one. And God spake all these what? What's the word? All these words, saying. So they had kind of taken that word, words, and they applied it to the Ten Commandments. And so for each statement, that would be one word. And sometimes we use that lingo in churches. Hey, that was a good word this morning. Was it just the one word? Pick a word. Which one did you like the most? It was referring to a statement. And for Exodus 20, God spake all of these commandments. And we must understand that the rules are not present just for the sake of having rules. It may feel like it at times, but their importance reaches far beyond just being a list of mandates or prohibitions. The 10 words or the 10 expressions of who God is, as we find it in our chapter, is a beautiful picture of the righteousness of God. We're gonna unpack that in just a second so we understand that a little bit better. But we must remember this morning that we have a holy God which is totally separate from sin, cannot exist in the same space as sin. Whether it's 613 laws that are designed to be kept, or if we whittle it down to 10, the number is irrelevant and the principle is primary. Each law reveals to us who God is. So I want you to think. I don't want you to skim ahead. I wish we had time this morning to do a quiz and see if we could recite all 10. That'd be interesting, right? So here's what I'd like to do, just as a little keeping you tuned in with me. I want you to look at the commandments through that lens. When you read a thou shalt not, I want you to say with me, just in one word, what attribute of God does that command highlight? For example, commandment number one, thou shalt not have any other gods before me. So if we were to whittle that down to one term, one attribute of God, what does that commandment teach you about who God is? God is what? Say it out loud real quick. Singular. There is not to be any other gods to be worshipped. There is no other capital G gods that exist at all. He is creator, he is sustainer, he is redeemer. There is only one God, and only one God deserves our worship. So you come to the second commandment. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. So God is to be what? Honored, that's a good word. What else? Separate, absolutely. What else? Reverenced. How about, we use this word a lot too, worshipped. Listen, we worship a lot of things, whether we realize it or not, and there is a void that is intrinsically available and present in our life, as Lamentations teaches us, and that emptiness, that void is only to be filled by God and a relationship with Him. But let's think about all the crazy things we try to cram into that emptiness and make it fit what God was supposed to fill. Third commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. God is to be what? Worshipped. Honored, somebody said that, reverenced. And we have to hold up that name. We have to respect that name as the only name whereby man can be saved. The fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Now, this is a little tricky one. It's the only commandment that we do not find repeated in the New Testament whatsoever. But I think the principle still stands there, and we would say that this would be the application, that God is sovereign. He is in his authority, created a seven-day week, and one of those days is to be set aside for worship and for rest. God's sovereign. Fifth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother. God is orderly. There are ways that these things play out the best. And listen, whether we like this rule or not, we are attempting as a culture to redefine that commandment. Sixth commandment, thou shalt not kill. God is authoritative. You can find other things about the sanctity of life that could fall under that one. Seventh commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery. God is faithful. The eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. Why? Because God is the owner of everything. The ninth commandment, thou shalt not bear false witness, because God is truth. And the tenth commandment, thou shalt not covet, because listen, God is good. We have no business looking at what everybody else has and wishing we had it, because we have to find a level of contentment in what God has already given to us. And so if you could imagine how much time that would take to go through 613 of them, let's just stick with the 10 this morning and remind ourselves this is who God is. And by creative authority and by his holiness, only God can decide what laws should be written and obeyed, because he is the creator and he, guess what, knows how these things ought to work the best. Therefore, our conclusion is, when it comes to the commands of God, we just do them, right? We obey. We submit ourselves underneath the authoritative words of God, and if it's the Ten Commandments by which we ought to live, then therefore, this is what we do. And honestly, at that point, we could close our eyes, bow our heads, and pray, and walk out of here. And if we do, I think we've done ourselves a great disservice. I don't think that's the end game. God has never been a God that operates from an outside-in confirmation. He is not looking for us simply to change the way that we behave ourselves and to dub that or to call that spirituality. That's not what the law is about. Listen, if I was ever going to take Ephesians 2 and ruin it and make my obedience to the law something to brag about, that's exactly how we would conclude that and say, look down my hypocritical nose and say, why can't you be as spiritual as I am? Look at me. If we were to end the series right there, the sermon there, right there. But that's not what this is about. You've got to remember in your mind the order by which this played out. This is not the spot where the message should end, because in doing so, if we preach a message that says the law is simply something to be obeyed, amen, let's pray, we've missed the purpose. Because again, God is a God of inside-out change. That is the ministry of the Holy Spirit on our lives, where we are shown our inadequacies and we are revealed our sins because of what the Holy Spirit does and because of what he has already done in our lives. Because we have been redeemed and given freedom, we change the way that we live. We don't change the way that we live to earn the redemption of God. Do you see the difference? Do you see how many religions are built on the converse, where it's all about my obedience and it's all about my faithfulness? I can only hope to God when I die I've been good enough. You know what they've done? They have taken the law and they have transposed it with the redemption of God, making redemption something that can be earned instead of something that can be received through grace by faith. Do you see the difference this morning? Listen, folks, this is huge. This is what it's all about. And so the commandments, we have them because it reveals to us something about who God is. But here's the second one, and I'm going to warn you before it even hits the screen. You're not going to like it. I hated it. I don't want to mention this one, because here's the second thought. The commandments reveal my imperfections. We didn't come to church to hear about that. We came to church to sing about the love of God and appreciate the cross of Christ and the redemption that is found, but we did not come to church this morning to hear about my imperfections and to learn about them and see them become magnified so that I have to deal with them. But as we look at the Ten Commandments, one thing we quickly realize is that all of us have broken at least one. Can we agree on that? Every one of us, if you look at the Ten Commandments, are guilty of at least one. Now, if we were to confine that into a chronology, probably daily we break at least one. Maybe more often. I mean, I want you to back that out. And what was that first statistic? 613? How many of those have you broken in the past day? And God only gives us 10, and we're supposed to obey that? We can't handle 10. To make matters more dismal, James chapter 2, verse 10 says this: for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of, say the last word, of all. Well, that's exciting. Listen to me. Are you encouraged yet today? I am so glad that I came to church to learn that if I break one law, I'm guilty of all of them. All has failed. I'm failed in life. There is no hope. That's what the law does, though. It reveals to us our imperfections. Think about this statement. You can be right 612 out of 613 times and still be wrong. My goal is to encourage you this morning. We're not there yet. Has the weight of the law hit you yet? With all of these rules, we understand that God is holy and he is righteous. Only he can establish and keep the laws because he is holy. Then why expect us to do the same? Because for us to maintain the law every single day, 24 hours out of the day, for us to do good all the time is, say it with me, it is impossible. We can't do it. We can try, and we do. We can put all of our effort into it, and we realize at the end of the day, I messed that one up, I'm guilty of everything, but here is the point. That is what the role of the law is to show us that we cannot keep the law on our own. It is impossible. Could it be that our idea and our purpose behind our understanding of the law is misguided? Because Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, defined for us why we have the law. Paul says, wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster, our teacher, our instructor, the one that helps us understand. So Paul says, the law is our teacher, so the question then is, what does it teach? All right, I told you, you're not going to like this point. We're going to get to the encouraging stuff, so stay with me. The law teaches us, first of all, while God is holy, we're not. I don't know many people that would even take the plunge and to make that statement that I believe myself to be perfect. I believe that I don't sin. I've never met one. Maybe a couple people have claimed it and they're foolish in that statement. Number two, what do we learn by the teacher of the law? We can try to keep the laws every day and the outcome is going to be the same. It's going to be discouraging. It's going to be frustrating. And how many times do you want to quit on Christianity because you realize this battle with sin is ongoing and it seems like I'll never win? You ever feel like that before? It seems like I every single day have to deal with this crazy thing called sin. And you wonder why heaven is so enticing and exciting and something to look forward to when we'll finally be released from the presence of temptation and the presence of sin. But as long as we are on this earth, listen, it gets frustrating, it gets tiring, and how many people do we know quit on God? Because the weight of the law rests solely and so heavily on their shoulders that they just say, I can't do this anymore. Christianity is not for me because all it is do this and don't do this. But what have they done? They have missed the lessons that the law is trying to teach. It's not about me doing X, Y, and Z. Not yet, anyway. You've transposed redemption in the law again. You've missed the point. The law teaches us on the bottom line that keeping the law cannot save you. And listen, it was never meant to save you. Galatians chapter 3, the rest of that verse says this, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster, which we just showed you, to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by, say the last word, please don't forget that word, that we might be justified by faith. You see, the law's existence as a teacher is to instruct us of our inability to maintain the law, to somehow earn our way into perfection, to earn our redemption, and to earn our spot into heaven. As a matter of fact, the law, the teacher of the law, is to instruct us that we can't do it on our own, and that we need somebody to step in and do something on our behalf. The teacher of the law is to point us to Christ. Remember with me, the gospel, as we know it, is not about you and I. Sure, we are the recipient of the benefits of the gospel, but the existence of the gospel is not about you and I. It is to bring us to Christ and to his glory that we might be justified, remember that word, by faith plus our obedience to the commandments, right? That's what it's all about. I got to have faith and then I got to obey and I got to do and I got to give and I got to serve. No. It is by grace through faith, period, that a person is redeemed. It is by grace through faith, period, that a man finds forgiveness of any sin. It is by grace through faith that a person inherits eternal life. And so the teacher of the law stands behind the classroom podium and instructs that this, we can't do it on our own. Stop trying. Because at which point we believe we can earn our salvation, grace has become null and void, because grace is not earnable. What did God then do about our sin problem? That's kind of, here we're going to make the transition into the encouraging now, because right now we feel like a bunch of failures sitting in one room. Did God just establish then more rules? Okay, you can't meet 10, so because you can't meet 10, let's give you 12 more. Because you can't do this, here, I'm going to make you do more to try to earn and work harder. Nope, that's not the way God worked. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 reminds us this. Instead of piling on more things to do, God intervenes, sees us in our sin problem, our inability to keep the law, and he sends for us that which only could be sent. He sends for us a holy sacrifice for an unholy people. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law. Christ didn't come to abolish it. As a matter of fact, what did he say? I come not to destroy it, but to fulfill. Because there is only one righteous man that ever walked on the dirt of this earth. And there's only one man that could come in holiness and perfection. And there's only one man that can come and could be our substitute. And that was Christ. Salvation, as we term it in church, our forgiveness of sins, our freedom from sin's punishment in hell forever, is not a reward for good works, but it is a gift of God that can be yours by faith in Jesus through his death and burial and resurrection. This is what we call the gospel. Warren Wiersbe said this: the law reveals God's righteousness and demands righteousness, but it can't give righteousness. Only Jesus Christ can do that. Listen, the law demands that we obey, and the law demands that we have righteousness, that we do everything correctly. But listen, there is one thing that the law cannot do, and the law cannot. It cannot apply righteousness on our behalf. It's not what it's there for. If it was, Christ's death would be in vain. The law is but a mirror that reflects our sin in our life, and it reminds us there is still a need to do something about that sin. All right, now we come back to our text, and we remember the progression of Israel before we even get into the Ten Commandments. And here is the encouraging statement. So we understand that God is holy and he is righteous, and the Ten Commandments remind us of that. We remind us of the second purpose of the commandments, that we aren't, more or less. But here's the last statement. The commandments come after redemption. Does this mean that after we're redeemed, after we're saved, all of the rules go out the window? No, that's not what this is saying. Paul actually says, the Greek word is meganoita, God forbid that we think that way, that because we're under grace, we live how we please. God forbid that line of thinking. But this is where the order of events is important, both in Israel and in the life of a Christian. Remember, Israel was enslaved. They were in bondage to Egypt, so were we. We were enslaved to sin. Israel was redeemed, and the same thing is true about us when we place our faith in Christ. We have freedom through redemption. Israel was given a new relationship. God would be their God, they would be his people, and they would walk in unity and in obedience to God. And the same thing is true about us. But you notice in the outline of the path of Israel, slavery, redemption, relationship, and then what? 20 chapters in, we find the law. We find the rules, as we like to term it. You have to notice this progression. Someone once said in a parenting book, I don't remember, it's been tossed around so many times, I don't even know who to give credit for, but it's not me, that rules without relationships lead to rebellion. Man, is that true. Rules without relationship leads to rebellion. And I'm going to tell you this much, that as we thought about that football scenario at the outset, when we decide that we want to live our lives and attempt to keep all of the rules, what ends up happening at the end of the game is a person rebels against God and walks away because they realize their sinfulness and they can't do anything about it. That's why this progression is so important. Do you understand where we're coming from with this? In this case, rules within a relationship leads to loving obedience. There is a huge difference between the two. Please get this. Once I am in Christ, as Paul says, once I am saved and my faith is in Christ, in other words, I am saved, I don't have to worry about the law anymore, right? No. Let's not go down that logic because that's not there. Jesus was the fulfillment of the law, and 613 was about. How many of you would like that idea? Could you imagine posting that on your walls at home? Get the wallpaper out. It's going to take up some space. And then you think, well, 10. 10 is still pretty tough. Then when we go into the New Testament, what if we looked at Jesus, who was the fulfillment of the law, and see if we can reduce this even farther? See if we can just keep 2 after the relationship has been established with our Lord. And so I want you to do this. Would you go over with me to Matthew chapter 22? And this is where we'll wrap things up. Let's look at Christ, who is the satisfaction, who is the fulfillment of the law, in Matthew 22. And I want you to see with me what happens then when Jesus gets pinned down on that question. Then out of all of the laws that exist, Lord, which one is the most important? Because wouldn't that help us understand what we are to obey after the fact, after we're redeemed? God, can you whittle this thing down to just 2? Maybe I can handle that. And so in Matthew chapter 22, let's start reading in, verse number 34. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, of course, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, Master, which is the great commandment, singular, I want you to remember that, singular, which is the great commandment in the law? As if to say, even if there was one rule, I could keep that. Hey, let me ask you real quick before we go any farther. If that was true, would the subsequent statement be true as well? If there was one law, would we be able to keep that? Yes or no? You know how we know the answer to that would be no? Go back to the book of Genesis chapter number 3 and find out from Adam and Eve what happened when they were just told, don't touch that fruit. Just one. And what do? The temptation was too great. So whether it's 613 or whether it's 1, what we have proven this morning is our inability to keep the law and our need for redemption by someone who can. But they pinned down Jesus hoping that they could somehow trick him into giving an answer and to dumbing down the law into one commandment. Back to the text. Verse 37, Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. In essence, with everything that I am, I had to love God. But verse number 38 says, this is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Wait a minute. They asked for 1, and God gave them how many? 2. Don't get tripped up by that. They are one and the same. You can't be right with other people unless you're right with the Lord. And you can't be right with the Lord unless you're right with others. This is a continuous thought. You want a great command to follow? Love the Lord your God with everything that's in you, and then find a way to love other people. Listen to me. Every time we fall into sin, it is always a love issue. Every time. It does not matter what sin it is that you are guilty of this Sunday, when you boil it down and you wipe away all of the excuses, it boils down to this one statement. We fall into sin because we chose to love me over what God has said every time. Every sin that we have is a demonstration of a love issue. And so while they try to pin Christ down, as a matter of fact, what it does is it provides Jesus opportunity to try to help us understand what it is that we're expected to do after we're redeemed. And you can connect Matthew chapter 22 back with Exodus chapter 20. Remember, he says this, love the Lord your God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. Well, that simple statement explains the first 4 commandments in Exodus chapter 20. All 4 of them deal with our relationship with God. Then you skip down 2 verses in verse number 39 of Matthew 22, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Well, that explains commandments 5 through 10. Which deal with interpersonal relationships. Our obedience then to God's desires for my life is a love issue. It's not a works issue. It's not a me trying to be good enough to earn God's grace issue. My obedience, then, to the commandments of God is a love issue. Is that not what John says or in John chapter 14, verse 15? If you love me, what will you do? Keep my commandments. Notice the difference. You're not keeping my commandments so that you can earn my love. You are keeping my commandments because you love. Listen to me. After we're redeemed, we have a growing understanding of what the commandments are all about. Those growing commandments and that growing understanding helps us to love God and to love others better. That's what Christ asks. So when you think, well, that sounds kind of familiar, I would hope at this point of the tenure of myself at this church, our mission statement as a church is to do what? We need to learn ways better to love God and to love people. And when we fail in either one of those categories, it all boils back down to what Christ said. It's a love issue. You have found a way to love yourself better than what God expects from you. Therefore, there's an issue. But because of redemption, and when we understand what that means in our lives, that being purchased out of slavery and being granted eternity and forgiveness of sins, is it asking too much that we live according to the expectations of God? Listen, wasn't asking too much to save your soul. Is it asking too much for us to obey then what he expects? And the beauty of it is, listen to me, God knows how this thing plays out the best. Why would we want anything different? So when we fully understand what redemption is about, obedience to his laws and to his teachings isn't any longer about my spirituality, and it's no longer about my earning God's grace. It's about me loving God enough who redeemed me, who died for me, and who is buried and rose again. I obey because I love him. Because nobody else has done that for me. Because he deserves that. It's about reprogramming us from always thinking me first. And it's realizing that it's all about loving God and loving others first. That is counterintuitive. It's not the way we're wired. We are wired to think me first. But God reminds us it's the opposite. And so God loved us enough to redeem us, to develop a relationship with us, and then he teaches us what ought to be done. Because again, when you think about rules, again, without trying to exhaust all of them that exist, okay? So don't get bogged down in the details, but as a general statement, rules in the home or rules in a society exist for our benefit. Again, is that always true? No, okay. So don't get caught up in the minute detail of that. But think specifically about your house. The rules that you establish in home are not so you can be this ugly tyrant who rules with an iron fist. It is because we love our children enough to establish some rules and boundaries to keep them safe. It's the same thing about God. Same exact principle as our Heavenly Father establishes rules for us, that because the relationship through redemption has already been formed, then we understand God wants what's best for me. Remember one of those commandments we boiled it down to? God is good. And that's what he wants for you and I, through salvation, through redemption, and through this process that we call sanctification, where we are continually learning and growing to become more like Christ. Hey, let me ask you this morning. Have you been playing football with the Ten Commandments? It's kind of a weird thought, I get it. And it's odd to see me in a jersey. I don't even own this one. Sue let me borrow it from the clothes pantry. Have you been playing football with the law? If so, what side of the ball are you on? Maybe you've fallen prey. Maybe this is kind of how you've always understood it to be, that the legalistic side of things is the purpose of the law, and it's about me following it. And maybe you don't even think that I'm trying to earn my salvation, but it's a level of spirituality, and we've missed the boat. It's not about my spirituality at all. It's about glory to God. I don't have anything. Listen, there is nothing in the world that we have to brag about when it comes to spirituality whatsoever. We haven't done any. All of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. But maybe you're on the other side of the ball, or maybe you know people that are and have conversations with them, and they believe that because they're already under grace, that they can live however they desire, they can do whatever they can indulge, they can live that me life. Listen, when me and the love of myself triumphs over my love for God, you've already stepped into a boundary that is unsafe and unbiblical. But I wonder this morning if there is a third team that we haven't talked about yet, and maybe you realize today that you're guilty. Maybe you're a part of this team. This team would consist of people that realize that they broke the laws of God, even if it's just one. If so, listen, you're in great company here. Every one of us are lawbreakers. That sounds rebellious, doesn't it? We are all spiritual criminals. And if you realize this morning that you are, and that the breaking of God's laws have not been forgiven in your life, then listen to me. Stop trying to keep the commandments of God and start with a relationship with Christ first. How do I do that? Remember the verse that Jeff had on the screen? We trust Christ by, what was that word? Faith. It's a faith issue. That's what the law is there for. To teach us our need for a Savior. How do I get that forgiveness? It's a faith thing. It's about me trusting someone else to do something that I could not do on my own. It's about trusting what Christ did on my behalf, and that by grace through faith, I can have my sins forgiven, and I can look forward to eternity in the presence of God, to His glory someday. Hey, which team are you on this morning? Would to God we would not be people that play football with the Ten Commandments, that would never appear on our headstone someday. But we would be on the team that says, I am simply a lawbreaker who's been forgiven by the grace of God for His glory. Would you bow with me this morning?